Welcome to church, everybody. Let's stand together. Good day to worship the Lord. Let's give him all our praise, everything. Sing this out together.
There's a temple full of light where my troubles, they run and hide. A tabernacle where you're adored, and I'm at home in the house of the Lord. A house of repentance, a place of redemption, an altar of worship where your praise is unending. The fortress I run to, where I need nothing more. In the
house. I am redeemed. I am set free. You can find me in my Father's house. I am redeemed. I am set free. You can find me in my Father's house. You gave me a name, a robe and a ring. I am embraced in my Father's house. A hope and a plan, purpose. on, church.
Jesus, all my hope in Jesus, love that never leaves us, He won't forsake us now. Jesus, faithful through the ages, of all my joys the greatest, the one and only Jesus.
And we're going to continue worship by celebrating through baptisms today. So why don't you turn your attentions to the screen right behind me.
Well, hey, good morning, Harvest family. We get to celebrate the Lord and all that He's doing through baptisms this morning. And so I'm here with Emery. And Emery, yeah, that's right. Emery is just going to share with us a little bit about what God has done in her life. So Emery, can you share with us, when did you commit your life to Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I grew up in a Christian household. I grew up going to Harvest, and I also grew up going to Awana. Every week my Awana leader would ask us if we knew Jesus in our heart and not just our head. And every time I wouldn't truly think about it, and I would just be like, oh yeah, I do. But then one time she asked that question, and I truly thought about if I did, and I realized I didn't. Then I meditated and prayed and then gave my life to Christ with God in both my head and my heart.
That's amazing. Praise God for what He did. And so since then, what has God been doing in your life?
God has given me the confidence and the realization to be myself, not to conform to the world, and not to change for people of this world because I'm made in His image.
It's so good. Okay, and Emery, why do you want to be baptized today?
I want to be baptized so I can share my faith with others and just be obedient to Christ, because he tells us to get baptized and I want to obey him.
Awesome. That's amazing. All right, well, Emery, based on your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, everyone, this is Lucy. Lucy, can you share with us when you committed your life to Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I've believed in Jesus as long as I can remember. This year during our Bible study church and the people I'm around, I've learned more about who Jesus is and decided I want to follow him my whole life.
That's amazing. Praise God that you decided that and he's working in your heart. So, Lucy, what has God been doing in your life since that day?
I was in bed and I think that he just spoke to me and said, Lucy, it's time for you to get baptized and I think it's time for you to follow me. He has also made me want to be around the people who love him.
That's good. And so, why do you want to be baptized today, Lucy?
Because I believe that Jesus is God and I want to follow him my whole life.
Amen. Well, awesome. Lucy, based on your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, everybody, this is Mallory. Mallory, can you just share with us, when did you commit your life to Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Well, actually, it was quite, I'm a crier, so if I cry. I've been through a lot. So I knew it was gonna be like this. I have a testimony that I think my parents would not want to listen to. I've been through a lot. I've met Jesus in the darkest times of my life when nobody was there. And I think that's just been like him chasing after me constantly and me just ignoring it and keep trying to be in control. I've done witchcraft. I've done horrible things against him, but he's still chased after me and reached out his hand to me and showed me in visions, and I've seen so many things, and he's just called me back, and finally I just said, I can't do this anymore. It's either you or that's it. And so that's been some of my testimony.
Yeah, so just recently, right?
Yeah.
It's been that you committed your life to Jesus.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Praise God that he is chasing you. So since then, what have you felt God is doing in your life? How is he changing you?
Oh,
what is he doing?
I mean, he just completely crumbled everything that I've known and that I've been, and everybody that I've known has left and has just introduced me to new people and show me that, like, when you follow him, there's nothing that you can't do or accomplish, and just his peace and the way that I feel him constantly, that's been the biggest thing.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. So now you're here, you made it. Why do you want to be baptized today?
He just called me. He's called me to get baptized and prove my final obedience to him. And this is the final thing to come into his kingdom and no matter what, not turn away from him.
That's right. That's right. Come on. All right. Well, then let's do that. Mallory, based on your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Let's stand as we respond to him. Generations, I know that you will keep. cry out to him today. Oh God.
Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. On your faithfulness. Power then, God moved in power now.
Jesus, you're the same yesterday and today and forever. Jesus, you're the same yesterday and today and forever.
As we remind ourselves of his faithfulness, that he hasn't changed, our natural response as the people of God is to declare how worthy he is. How worthy he is of all of our lives. And so we sing this as a church, as a response to him.
You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things, and you deserve the glory.
Home with everything you've got, we declare he's worthy.
You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all. To you are all things. Oh, you deserve the glory.
Church, if you're comfortable in this place, can we lift our hands to the worthy one as we sing?
You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things. And to you are.
Yes, Jesus, you are worthy of it all. You're worthy of our lives. You're worthy of our song. You're worthy of every part of our lives. As we remind ourselves even how faithful you've been, that you've answered prayers back then and you're going to answer prayers right now, that you moved in power back then, you're moving in power right now, that you were a savior then and you're still a savior now. Salvation belongs to you, God. And we just remind ourselves that you are worthy as we declare that you are worthy, worthy, worthy. We give you all the honor. We give you all the praise. And in Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Harvest, go ahead and take a seat. That's right. We serve a God who is worthy of everything that we have. And it's an honor and a privilege to come together and to worship him, because he's worthy of all of the honor and all of the praise. My name is Ramirez Moody. I'm the pastor for this campus, and I'm so glad to be in the house of the Lord. It's my favorite part of the week. I hope the same is true for you, where we get to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And if this is your first time joining us, I'd like to welcome you personally. So after church, I'll be in the lobby in the welcome section. Just stop by for a moment. I'd just love to see how I could serve you during your time here at Harvest Bible Chapel. Speaking of serving the people of our church, we have this thing called the Harvest Bible Chapel app that allows us to do that well. We could serve you by letting you know the things that are happening here at Harvest, but we can also serve you through prayer requests. So if you have it downloaded on your phone, this will be a good time to pull that out. And also, not only submit prayer requests and to find out what's happening here, but you can also check in and let us know that you're here today. And ladies, while you're there, you can register for the Women on Mission Retreat. The registration is open today in the app. And this is a retreat that's happening on March 14th and 15th. It's a Friday and Saturday. So don't miss this opportunity to gather together with the ladies of all of our campuses in Delavan, Wisconsin at the Lake Lawn Resort. All right, so check that out. Or at the very least, save the date if you don't know for sure if you can go. This Monday, we have an opportunity to take a pause and to reflect and remember our veterans. There are men and women who have answered the call for this country and have sacrificed their needs for the needs of our country. We also acknowledge that there are men and women all over the world that have done the same for their country to defend against other evildoers that want to do wrong against their sovereignty. So let's take this pause to reflect on that for a moment. We'll get an opportunity to do that on Monday as well, but we're going to do it here in this service. As I read this verse over you, it says this in John chapter 15, verse 13. Greater love has no one than this, that someone would lay down his life for a friend. Those who have served in our military all over the world have done just that. They've laid down their lives. I was actually named after someone who laid down his life in the Vietnam War. So let's take a pause and let's ask those service members who have served our country to just stand. Or if you're currently serving our country, will you stand so that we can just acknowledge you? Yeah. Thank you, guys. Also, the family members of service members as well, could you stand? Because you're serving as well. Yes, thank you. It's the families that make the sacrifice too, right? Yeah, we thank you for your sacrifice. In our continuing effort to pray for like-minded churches, this week we're praying for Jezron Presbyterian Church in Arlington Heights and their senior pastor, Song Chun. And Song is the father of our very own Moses Chun, who is our worship leader here at this campus. Chun, sorry. And so we're going to pray for them for in a minute. But first, let me read this over us this morning. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 through 7. It says this: each one must give what he has decided in his own heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. You know, each week we gather together to worship the Lord in song and in his word, but we also get an opportunity to worship him through our giving. But as we do that, we want to make sure that we're giving with the right heart. And so if you take a look at the screen here, it's no different than any other week. These are the options that you have to give here at Harvest Bible Chapel to further ministry here. But it is our hope that not only that our heart is aligned with the Lord, but then also if our heart is aligned, our attitude will be aligned as well. All right? And so it is our hope that here at Harvest Bible Chapel, we will be generous givers, giving with the right heart. So let's go before the Lord and pray for the offerings and also pray for Jeshuan Presbyterian Church in Arlington Heights. Will you join me in that? Lord, we thank you for everything that you've done in Jeshuan Presbyterian. Of God, we're praising you and asking you to move for the things that you are still yet to do. We're rejoicing in that. Lord, will you continue to provide all the needs of their church and on their staff as well? I pray that Pastor Song will not grow weary in doing well. I pray that no weapon form will prosper in this ministry, but that they will take the gospel further than we could have ever imagined. And Lord, for the offerings that are being presented to this morning, it's our prayer that it will be pleasing in your sight. Use it to further the gospel through Harvest Bible Chapel in the community, in the city, and across nations. We thank you, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, Harvest, why don't you greet someone who you did not come to church with this morning?
morning, church. Good morning. It's good to see you. If you're new here, my name's Tommy Creutz. I serve as the campus pastor of our Crystal Lake campus, but also on our teaching team. And so I have the privilege of sharing God's word with us this morning. And so you're going to need a Bible, and you're going to need to open it up to Genesis chapter 40. And as you're going there, I want to give you a little bit of a, maybe a softball question, if you will. All right. Who here, by a show of hands, loves a great story? How many? All of us? Yeah, right? We all love great stories. Great stories that I love are like Lord of the Rings, Star Wars. Why? Because I'm a nerd, okay? I love them. Maybe for you it's different stories. Maybe it's a story about a sports team or a love story or something that you have read or something that you have watched. The thing, though, about great stories is that great stories are never straight lines, are they? Right? They're never straight lines. You never have, you know, you've got the beginning of the story. There's this dot, and there's a dot. There we go. You have the beginning of the story, and you have the end of the story. Great stories are never like this, are they? Just a straight line. Never. Like, what would this story be like? Okay, so there's this group of people. They started in the Shire, and then some things happened, and they ended in the Shire. Good for them. Great story? No, not a good story. Well, let's take it even further. There was a poor man, and then some things happened, and he became a rich man. Well, that's good for him, right? Great story? No, not a great story. Because great stories are never straight lines. In fact, they almost always have twists and turns and ups and downs and victories and defeats and hardship and perseverance. And then it comes to this climactic moment in the story where good triumphs over evil, or the good guy defeats the bad guy and everyone's cheering. Great story, right? They tend to look more like this. It's never a straight line. And what we're gonna see in continuing of our story through the story of Joseph and today is that Joseph's story is certainly not a straight line by any means. It has its ups, it has its downs, it has its victories, it has its defeats, its triumphs, its twists, its turns. But what we're gonna see through all of that, we're gonna see Joseph's faithful presence, no matter what. His faithful presence. So we're gonna be in Genesis chapter 40. We're gonna be going almost to the end of chapter 41. So we're almost getting through two chapters this morning. So I hope you got did you guys all get the Friday email that said that this was gonna be about 2 hours long? Did you guys get that? Just kidding, 4 hours? I'm just kidding, it's not. But we have a lot of text to get through today. Almost two chapters full. And so what we're gonna do is I'm gonna tell the story with three stops along the way, and then we're going to apply the story to our life. Sound good? All right, seatbelts on, here we go. Genesis 40, starting in verse 1. Sometime after this, we already have to stop. I'm so sorry, I know we've got a lot of text. We already have to stop because we have to ask the question, what's this? What is it referring to? What happened before this? And so we don't have to go very far. Just turn back one chapter, 39. If you were here last week, you'll remember the story. Potiphar's wife had some advances on Joseph, and Joseph declined those advances, and then she lied about Joseph and said that he was the one who had advances towards her. And then this happens in chapter 39, verse 20. And Joseph's master, Potiphar, took him and put him into the prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. And he was there in prison. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him what? Favor. This is our first stop in the story, is favor. He gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever was done there, he was the one who did it. The keeper of the prison paid no attention to anything that was in Joseph's charge because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made succeed. So that is what happened before, and then there's the sometime after this. But do you see he gained favor? He was thrown into the pit, and then he gained favor. And what I want to do is I want to back up. I want to zoom out on the story of Joseph to show this trend, this narrative trend in Joseph's life. In fact, we're going to go all the way back. I'm going to draw a little picture for us. We have favor, and we have the pit. All the way back in chapter 37, Joseph is favored by his father, Jacob, right? And how do we know that he's favored? He's given the multicolored coat, and he is Jacob's favorite son. And Joseph then goes on to have some dreams about all of his family bowing down to him, specifically his brothers bowing down and his mother and father bowing down to him. His brothers did not like that very much. They're like, look at this arrogant little punk with his fancy coat telling us that we're going to be bowing down to him. And they hated him. They hated Joseph. And so one day while they were all out in the field, Joseph went out to the brothers. And as he was a far way off, they plotted that when he comes, they were going to kill him because they hated him. And so Joseph got there. They tore his cloak off of him and threw him into the pit. Went from the favorite son to now in a pit. They were going to kill him. But then Judah, one of his brothers, had this great idea. Instead of killing Joseph, what if we could make a profit off of this? They saw some traveling merchants. They called them over, and they ended up selling Joseph into slavery. They dipped his coat into animal blood, and they brought it back to their father, Jacob, and he was devastated. And then Joseph was sent off as a slave to Egypt into Potiphar's house. But through his faithfulness, his diligence, and the Lord, he found favor in the eyes of Potiphar. And he was made over all of the house. He was given authority over all of the house. He took care of all of the dealings that were happening in the house. He was favored. Then Potiphar's wife liked Joseph and wanted to lie with Joseph. Joseph refused. She lied and said that he was the one that was trying to get with her. And Potiphar threw Joseph into the pit, into prison. Through his faithfulness and his diligence and the Lord in prison, he was given favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. You see how this is happening through the entire narrative of Joseph's story. Favor, pit, favor, pit, favor, right? What we see here is a lot like what we saw a little bit earlier about great stories, right? There is a great story that is unfolding in Joseph's life. And not only that, but we can see the hand of God moving through each moment of this story. In the favor and in the pit, and in the favor and in the pit, God's hand is moving through every single part of it. And this story is no different. So sometime after this, after he's put in prison, the cupbearer of the king of Egypt, cupbearer is like a butler, and his baker, the one who bakes, committed an offense against their lord, the king of Egypt. And Pharaoh was angry with his two officers, the chief cupbearer and the chief baker, and he put them in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, in the prison where Joseph was confined. The captain of the guard appointed Joseph to be with them, and he attended them. They continued for some time in custody. What's really interesting to note here is the title of the captain of the guard. Does anyone remember who the captain of the guard is? It's Potiphar. Potiphar is the captain of the guard, which means that Potiphar is the one who appointed Joseph to be over these high-profile, influential prisoners, the chief cupbearer, the chief baker. These are high-profile prisoners. And Potiphar is the one who has appointed Joseph to be over them. So I think that then provokes a question from us. Would Potiphar have put Joseph in charge of these high-profile prisoners if he hadn't seen firsthand how successful and responsible Joseph was in his house. It's almost like Joseph had to go through the ups and the downs in Potiphar's house to be in the position that he is in right now. Coincidence? Luck? Or is this, in fact, the hand of God yet again moving through the story of Joseph? It's that one. It's the last one that I just said. It is the hand of God moving through the story of Joseph. Joseph now has these high-profile, influential prisoners under his care. In verse 5, and one night they both dreamed. The cupbearer and the baker of the king of Egypt, who were confined in the prison, each his own dream, and each dream with its own interpretation. When Joseph came to them in the morning, he saw that they were troubled. So he asked Pharaoh's officers who were with him in custody in his master's house, "Why are your faces downcast today?" And they said to him, "We have had dreams, and there is no one to interpret them." And Joseph said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Please tell them to me." Back in this day, dreams were believed to be the main vehicle of divine revelation. And the only one who could interpret the dreams of the gods were professional magicians or professional wise men. Joseph knows this, but he actually turns it a bit on its head and he says, "Do not interpretations belong to God?" God, who gave the revelation, certainly he could be the one who provides the interpretation to whomever he chooses. And so what we see here is Joseph's faithful presence, knowing that the Lord is with him. Listen, we've never seen Joseph have the ability to interpret dreams before in this story. Now, Joseph had dreams, right, in the beginning in chapter 37. He had dreams, but he didn't interpret those dreams. His brothers actually interpreted those dreams. His father interpreted the dream. He hasn't shown this ability to interpret dreams. But Joseph knew that the Lord was with him and he had a faithful presence. And so he said, you know, well, listen, in faith, maybe the Lord will give me the ability to interpret these dreams. So tell them to me. Maybe this is the way that the Lord is leading me out of this prison. Maybe he will provide. So Joseph, after hearing the dream of the cupbearer first, he has a dream about these three branches and putting a cup in Pharaoh's hand and squeezing the grapes into them. He interprets the dream, Joseph does, and it's favorable. He says that in 3 days, the cupbearer will go before Pharaoh and he will be reinstated into his position. Now, Joseph giving this interpretation might be thinking, hey, you know, God, you just gave me the ability to interpret these dreams, and they look pretty favorable. This guy is about to go through the most powerful person in the land, Pharaoh. He's about to get FaceTime with him. Maybe this is the way that you are providing the open door, as we would say as Christians, right? Maybe this is an open door for me to get out of this prison. Maybe this is you leading me. And so Joseph asks a favor. Joseph asks a favor of the cupbearer. He says, "Only remember me when it is well with you, and please do me the kindness to mention me to Pharaoh, and so get me out of this house." He's pleading with him. Just let him know about me. Remember me. For I was indeed stolen out of the land of the Hebrews, and here also I have done nothing that they should put me into the pit. Joseph is pleading his case to, I am innocent. I didn't do anything. I was stolen out of my land and I didn't do anything that should make me be in prison right now. I'm an innocent man. This is unjust. So just put in a good word when you meet Pharaoh, when you get out of here, put in a good word for me. Most of us have maybe been in this situation, maybe at work, right? Maybe you've been working on a project with a group of people and that person is then gonna go and present this project to the higher ups in the company. And you're like, listen, if it goes well, just put my name out there. Tommy helped with this project. What a smart guy that guy is. What a good guy Tommy is. We just put my name out there and maybe something's going to change in my life. Maybe I'll get a higher position or a raise. Just put my name out there. Remember me when we have some success in this area. He's asking the cupbearer for a favor. The chief baker then gets really excited about this favorable interpretation of the dream, right? He's like, all right, me next, come on. Tell me, I'm getting back into my position too. I'm gonna get out of this prison. Chief baker shares his dream, which he has three cake baskets on his head, but the birds don't eat the food that's in front of Pharaoh. Instead, they eat the food that is out on from the basket on his head. Joseph interprets the dream. It says, in 3 days, it's the three baskets, you will go before Pharaoh, but he's going to kill you. Oof, not great. Can you imagine being the chief baker? Comes in all excited and then, oh my goodness. And wouldn't you know that is exactly what happened. That's exactly what happened in verse 20. On the third day, it was Pharaoh's birthday. He made a feast for all of his servants. He lifted up the head of the chief cupbearer and the chief baker. And he restored the chief cupbearer to his position and placed the cup in Pharaoh's hand, but he hanged the chief baker, as Joseph had interpreted to them. So you're thinking at this point in the story, everything that Joseph interpreted came true, and any day now he's gonna tell Pharaoh, right, about him, because he interpreted the dream correctly. And he asked the cupbearer, hey, remember me. So he's gonna remember, and then this is the way that Joseph is going to get out of the prison and back into favor somewhere, right? The chief cupbearer for sure is going to remember Joseph. Yet, the chief cupbearer did not remember Joseph, but forgot him. This is the second stop that we're going to make in our story, which is forgotten. The chief cupbearer did not remember Joseph, but forgot him. Now, are we talking about like just in that moment, like because he was really excited and all of these good things were happening to him and he just got, it just flew out of his mind for a little bit? Surely he didn't, forget for a really long time, right? Surely he remembered the next day. Or surely maybe as the party died down, he remembered the next week, right? Surely. After 2 whole years, ouch, Pharaoh dreamed that he was standing by the Nile. The chief cupbearer forgot about Joseph, not for a day, not for a couple days, not for a week, not even for a month, but after 2 whole years. Pretty big deal. This is not like, oh man, I forgot about that appointment I made on my calendar. Oh, whoops, I forgot my wallet at home or my keys at home. No, this guy forgot a whole human being in prison who helped him out and gave him a favorable interpretation of his dream that then came true. Imagine just for a moment being in Joseph's position. He's probably thinking while he's down in prison, any day now, any day that cupbearer is going to tell Pharaoh and I'm going to be walking my way out of this prison because I'm here unjustly, any day. And then a week passes and he's like, any day. And then a month passes and he's, any day. And then a year passes, he's forgotten. Put yourself in his shoes for just a moment. You see, the text says nothing about what Joseph was feeling or that he even complained about all of this, but put yourself in his shoes. If you were in Joseph's spot, how would you react to this, being forgotten? God, I'm doing all the right things. I am being faithful in the good moments of my life and in these pit moments of my life. I am being faithful. Why are you doing this? Are you mad at me? Did I do something wrong? Have you, like the cupbearer, forgot? Have you forgotten me? See, one thing that's interesting about the story of Joseph is that it is a direct conflict with a prevalent view that is in the world, but has also creeped its way into Christianity. And that is this view that if I do good, then only good things are going to happen to me. If I do bad, then only bad things are going to happen to me. right? Like karma, prevalent view. And people bring this into Christianity and they use verses like you reap what you sow. So if I sow good things, then I will reap good things. And if I sow bad things, I will reap bad things. And then we kind of have this system of belief forming in Christianity. I like to call it karmic Christianity, right? I will get good things if I do good things. And this view has infiltrated Christianity, and what it has built inside of the Christian belief is this idea that we need to do better and be better, and when we do better and we are better, then God will give us good blessings. And we think that somehow when things go wrong in our life, it's because we've done something wrong. When a hard circumstance comes, we blame ourselves, right? We say, what did I do against you, God? What did I do wrong? And that creates this cycle of trying to do better and trying to be better. And maybe if I just do better and I am better, then these bad things won't happen in my life. Everything will be good that comes to me. Joseph's story and many stories in the Bible are in direct conflict to that belief, right? Because Joseph is faithfully doing the right things, and yet these bad situations are still happening to him. He is faithfully doing the right things. Potiphar's wife tries to seduce him. He does the right thing and rejects it. And he receives all of this blessing, right? No, he goes to prison. Well, in prison, he's faithful and gains favor. And he steps out in faith with the chief cupbearer and the baker and interprets their dreams. He does the right thing. And so then he's showered with good blessings, right? He's forgotten. He's forgotten. What's so important to see here is that throughout all of this, the good and the bad, every circumstance, God is operating his plan in the favor and in the pit. He is operating and moving forward his plan, no matter what circumstance Joseph is finding himself in. And while Joseph may have been forgotten by the cupbearer, that's really important to understand. The cupbearer is the one who forgot Joseph. We need to understand that God has not forgotten Joseph. He has not forgotten about Joseph. And maybe you're in a season like that, in the pit, forgotten. And we need to remember that while others have forgotten about us, God has not forgotten about us. And his hand is moving forward his plans in our life, regardless of the ups and the downs, the favor in the pit. That's the second one, forgotten. Favor, forgotten. Here's the third one, Pharaoh. Favor, forgotten, Pharaoh. I couldn't think of another word that started with F, so we got the closest thing that we could get, Pharaoh. Favor, forgotten, Pharaoh. After the 2 years, Pharaoh has a dream. He dreamed of 7 plump cows and 7 thin cows. And the 7 thin cows eat the plump cows, and that disturbs him, so he wakes up. This is a nightmare for Pharaoh. My nightmares are very different than Pharaoh's nightmares. Maybe yours are too. Giant spiders are chasing me in my nightmares. He's dreaming about cows. He goes to bed again, and he has another dream, and that dream is of 7 plump ears of grain, and then also 7 ears of grain that were thin and bad, and the 7 bad ears swallow up the plump ones, and he is troubled by this dream. He's troubled by the dreams that he had. He can't figure it out, and so he brings all of the professional magicians and all of the wise men of the land together to interpret this dream, but they cannot. They cannot interpret this dream. Then in comes the chief cupbearer, and he said to Pharaoh, I remember my offenses today, 2 years later. When Pharaoh was angry with his servants and put me and the chief baker in custody in the house of the captain of the guard, we dreamed on the same night, he and I, each having a dream with its own interpretation. A young Hebrew was there with us, a servant of the captain of the guard. When we told him, he interpreted our dreams to us, giving an interpretation to each man according to his dream. And as he interpreted to us, so it came about. I was restored to my office, and the baker was hanged. About time, buddy, right? About time, 2 years. My goodness, could you not have, like, remembered that, 2 years ago? No, he couldn't have. This is the interesting part of the story. No, he could not have remembered it 2 years ago. Do you see what's happening in the story? Do you see? What is the thing that is going to bring Joseph to Pharaoh? It's the dream. Pharaoh didn't dream 2 years ago. It's the interpretation of that dream that is going to get Joseph to Pharaoh. In fact, God chose the exact right moment for Joseph to go before Pharaoh. It couldn't have happened 2 years ago. It needed to be right now. His timing is perfect. God is orchestrating every single part of this story. Do you see it? In all of the details, in all of the timing, in the ups and in the downs, even when Joseph was forgotten, God was planning and pushing his plans forward for Joseph's life. And in the exact right moment, Pharaoh sent and called Joseph, and they quickly brought him out of the pit. And when he had shaved himself and changed his clothes, he came in before Pharaoh. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, I have had a dream, and there is no one who can interpret it. I have heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. Joseph answered Pharaoh, it is not in me. God will give Pharaoh a favorable answer. So Joseph is brought before the most powerful man in the world, Pharaoh. And what does he do? He honors God. He is faithful, faithful, faithful. There's a lot of things that Joseph could have said in front of the most powerful man in the world. He could have bragged about himself. Pharaoh, I am the one. I'm the guy. I interpret the dreams. I'm really good at it. In fact, I have not been wrong yet. And so I'm gonna be able to help you out. And so if you can maybe help me out with something, if you get me out of prison, I will absolutely do this for you because I'm the best dream interpreter probably alive, right? He could have bragged about himself. Could have shown Pharaoh his value. He also could have pleaded his innocence before Pharaoh. Could have pleaded his innocence. I don't belong in prison. I shouldn't even be here. Pharaoh, you are the most powerful person. Please get me out of the situation that I'm in, and then I'll do my best to help you. But instead, what Joseph does is he places God in his rightful place, and he is faithful. God is the one who does the work. It's not in Joseph. So Pharaoh tells him his dream. Joseph interprets the dream that because there were two dreams, because it was twice that God is fixed on doing this thing. And this thing is that the seven plump and good cows and plump and good grain, they symbolize 7 years of plenty that's going to happen in the land. And the seven thin cows and the seven thin grain symbolizes 7 years of severe famine that is going to happen in the land. So Pharaoh, what you need to do here is you need to set over the land discerning men who will oversee and stockpile resources in the years that are plentiful so that when those 7 years of severe famine are going to happen, you're going to be able to save your people and you're going to be able to save the land. This proposal pleased Pharaoh and all his servants And Pharaoh said to his servants, can we find a man like this in whom is the Spirit of God? Pharaoh recognizes where this is all coming from God. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has shown you all this, there is none so discerning and wise as you. Incorrect, that was God. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall order themselves as you command. Only as regards to the throne will I be greater than you. What is happening in this story? And Pharaoh said to Joseph, see, I have set you over all the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand and clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain about his neck. And he made him ride in his second chariot. And they called out before him, bow the knee. Thus he set him over all the land of Egypt. Moreover, Pharaoh said to Joseph, I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no one shall lift up hand or foot in all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh called Joseph's name Zaphnath-Paneah, and he gave him in marriage Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On. So Joseph went out over the land of Egypt. And everyone said, amen, and woe. What just happened? This is like the greatest rags to riches story ever. From the prison to the palace. He was in prison. And in what, a day? He was not only in the palace, but he was over the palace. What a rise that is. Only God. Only God. It's pretty remarkable. That's the end of our story for the day. Go ahead, give yourself a round of applause. We did it. Almost two chapters, guys. We made it through. Before we get into the application, though, I want to give us a sense of scale, a timeline, if you will, of how long all of this is happening. Because I think sometimes what can happen is we read through the scriptures, especially when we're only in, what, four verses or so of Joseph, or sorry, four chapters of that as it relates to Joseph. We can tend to think that this is all happening pretty quickly, right? It's only four chapters. Surely this is happening, bam, 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 right after another. Couldn't possibly have been taking that long. He probably wasn't in turmoil for that long, probably wasn't in those favorable positions for that long. But let me just borrow. I'm going to borrow one verse, just one verse from next week's message. Hope Jeff isn't upset. And it's this, verse 46. Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Okay, so in this moment of the story where we are at with Joseph, he is 30 years old. Does anyone remember how old Joseph was when we met him back in chapter 37? 17. He was 17 years old, which means that over the course of these four chapters concerning Joseph, it has been 13 years. 13 years have passed. Which means we don't know how long Joseph was a regular slave before he was elevated in Potiphar's house. We don't know how long Joseph was in that elevated position in Potiphar's house. We don't know how long Joseph was in prison. All that we know is that he was in there sometime after he was thrown in. The only thing that we really know is that he was in there at least 2 years after he was forgotten by the cupbearer. 13 years of up and down and up and down, long stints of time spent in the waiting. Waiting, waiting, waiting. God had given this dream that his family was going to bow down before him, and then 13 years of waiting. God, when is this going to happen? I've been waiting. It's been over a decade. So what did Joseph do in that long season of waiting that could be helpful for us? What did he do? Here's the first point of application, is that I do the next right thing, regardless of my circumstance. I do the next right thing, regardless of my circumstance. I want to draw this picture again of Joseph's life. Favor,
almost, still almost, there we go, and pit.
This was Joseph's life, right? But it's not just Joseph's life. If you look at this, how many of you would say that, oh, that looks also a lot like my life, right? It looks a lot like my life. There have been ups, there have been downs, there have been moments of favor, there have been moments in the pit. My life actually looks a lot like Joseph's life. Maybe different situations, maybe it's not being thrown in prison or thrown in a literal pit, but you've had these moments in your life of ups and downs, favor and pits. And the thing that we learn about Joseph as he goes through this, one thing that is silent throughout the story is that there is no whining from Joseph. Do you notice that? Do you notice that? Joseph isn't whining. He's not complaining. Why does the author, did he? I don't know. We might get to heaven one day and ask Joseph, and he's like, yeah, I cried a lot. You know, I whined a lot. That was hard. Maybe. But the authors don't include it. Why? What is the characteristic of Joseph that the author is highlighting? Faithful presence through the midst of the good and the bad. Faithful presence. And Joseph continues time after time after time with Potiphar's wife, with the prisoners, with his responsibilities. He keeps doing the next right thing. And listen, church, we're not in control of our circumstances. You are not in control of your circumstances. As much as we might believe that we are not in control of our circumstances. Things can change in our life for the better or worse tomorrow. We're not in control of the circumstances that happen to us, but we are in control of how we respond to them. We're in control of our actions. So what are we supposed to do? The next right thing, just like Joseph. Why? Because, here's the second thing, even when I don't see it, God's plan is progressing. Even when I don't see it, God's plan is progressing. One of the things that this picture reminds me of is the stock market, right? Reminds me of the stock market. And can I just tell you, I am afraid of the stock market. I'm terrified of it because it looks like that, you know, and up and down. I would much prefer if the stock market just looked like steady up and to the right, you know. That would be nice, right? That would be nice. I feel like I could get on board with that. Up and to the right, that looks good to me. But it isn't, right? It's like this. Up and down, and you're never quite sure how down it's going to continue to go down, right? I never know, like, you know, if I'm like, oh, that looks like a good place to jump in, and then you jump in, and then it keeps going, and you're like, there goes all my money. Or it's up here, and you're like, oh, it's good. That looks like a good place to jump in, and then it goes like that, and you're like, and there goes all my money, right? Like, it's up, and it's down, and we're never sure how far it's going to go down or how up it's going to go, and we do not like that, right? We want the sure thing. We want the promise of continual success and favor. We want it to go up and to the right always. So that sure looks like the stock market, but it looks like our lives going up and down, and we're not quite sure how down it's going to go or how up it's going to go. And so what you do is you zoom out. You zoom out into the big picture, and what you tend to see when you're not looking at the short term, not just looking at this individual moment in time or this individual moment in time, when you zoom out a little bit, what you then see is that there is a trend happening that is actually up and to the right. It is actually up and to the right over time. The thing about God is he seems to like squiggly lines, not straight ones. We're always looking for the shortest distance between two points, which is a straight line. We're always looking for the path of least resistance. We don't want it to hurt. We want it to be good the whole way. God, though, is looking for the best path, not the shortest, not the one of least resistance, the best path. And so what this then means for us as Christians is it means that it's going to take perseverance. It's going to take perseverance. It took 13 years of ups and downs for Joseph to be ready to step into the palace. And in those moments of trial, over the 13 years of faithful presence, he was being tested and prepared for what was yet to come. Joseph was not ready at 17 in the ways that he was ready at 30. In fact, he was not ready at 28 in the ways that he was ready at 30. The Lord was growing him, testing and preparing him for what was to come. And we see this in the New Testament, right? It's why we have verses like James 1, 2 through 4. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, perseverance, and let steadfastness have its full effect that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. 1 Peter 1, 3 through 7, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, keeping in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. It is going to take perseverance, Christian. Because even when it doesn't look like it, God's plan is progressing and he is growing us. And listen, sometimes the most growth comes from the most painful moments. Sometimes the most growth in our faith and in our life come from the most painful moments. Let me give you an example of that in our bodies. I don't know if maybe you've noticed, maybe you haven't. I've lost a little bit of weight. I have lost 41 pounds over the past couple of months. And, thank you. So I started working out a couple of months ago, and this was new for me, getting back into it. And can I just tell you, I've been sore every day in some part of my body for 3 months. In fact, I am sore right now. My legs hurt to the touch. I didn't know that was a thing. I think something's wrong with me. I almost didn't make it up the stairs. It's sore. I have been sore every day. And the interesting thing, though, about that is it hurts, right? It's painful. When I think about my soreness, I'm like, yeah, no, I don't want to go back to the gym. In fact, I just want to lay in my bed and look at the ceiling. But that soreness, what's happening as your muscles are sore, as you work them out, they get sore, they are healing, repairing, and they are getting stronger. They are growing. And so you have this painful moment of soreness in your body. And yet what's happening through that pain, what's happening through those moments of not being able to walk or lift your hands up, is growth and strength in your body. The most painful moments lead to the most growth. I think you could probably look back at your life. I know I certainly could. Looking at some of the most painful moments and our life as a family, and what we've seen and what you've seen is that the Lord grew you tremendously through those moments. It's hard to see it when you're in it. I don't see the growth of my muscle, I just feel the pain. It's hard to see when you are in those painful moments, but God is growing. He is growing you. He's using the ups and downs, just like in Joseph's life, to grow him from the pit to the palace. He's doing that same work in you. He's doing the same work that he is doing in Joseph in you, in your life. And I know that the waiting in the pit especially is hard. Waiting in the favor is a little easier, right? But waiting in the pit, waiting in the prison, feeling forgotten, it's hard. But listen, he is building in you the same thing that he is building in Joseph. And that is the knowledge that despite what it might look like, things are headed up and to the right. That his plans are progressing forward in your life. And he is building in each one of us through the painful moments, through the highs and the lows. He is building in us an unshakable confidence in the providence of God. Unshakable. Confident in the providence of God. So let's be like Joseph. And let's remain faithful. Amen? Let me pray for us. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for its instruction and its stories, Lord. And Lord, I thank you for the fact that you are sovereign over the highs, over the lows, over every single part of our life, and that you show yourself through this story of Joseph. In every single detail, you are there, and you are with him, and you are building in him something. You are progressing your plans forward in his life. And Lord, would you give us the confidence to believe that you are building the same thing in us? You are doing the same work in our life. You were faithful here. You are faithful in our life. So Lord, would you be with us in the waiting? I pray for anyone who is in that season right now, in the pit, and it's been a long season. God, would they know that you are near? You are near those who are brokenhearted and save those who are crushed in spirit. And so if anyone is that, feeling that right now in the waiting, would they feel your nearness? Would you build in them the confidence, the knowledge that you are pushing things forward? Your plans are perfect and you work things together for our good. Help us to have that unshakable confidence in your providence, Lord. Help us to remain faithful in the favor and in the trial. We look to you, Lord. We trust you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
With me.
Thank God that we can sing that in confidence, right? For those that have put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, it is well with our soul. But God never promised that every day was going to be amazing, right? But we look at the story of Joseph as an example of someone who stayed consistent through all of the trials and troubles that he faced. From betrayal to temptation, he stayed consistent. Over 13 years. For some of us, it's been 13 days or 13 months. But God promised that he would be there all the way, right? Do you believe that? Amen. Yeah. But for some, it could be tough. So we'll have people up front to help you with that, to pray for you and to bear your burdens with you. And that's what we get to do as a community. And that's what we get to do when we come together on the weekends, is not only worship the Lord together, but also encourage one another. So don't, if you need encouragement, don't leave here without that. There'll be people up front. And if you are newer to Harvest Bible Chapel and I have not had an opportunity to meet you yet, I will be in the welcome area. And just remember, no matter what you go through in life, God has promised that he will be there. And he is reliable and he is truth. And we can take that to the bank, okay? So as you go out on mission for Jesus Christ this week, remember that and remember that you are loved. Take care.